Good morning, everyone. Today's topic for the PG activity is endometrial biopsy reporting. So we'll start with the introduction. So interpreting an endometrial biopsy, we have to take into account different factors like patient history, appreciation of the limitations, and specific requests by the clinician who's performing the biopsy. So there are various indications of performing an endometrial biopsy. So they have been divided into bleeding and non-bleeding causes. So the bleeding causes include abnormal uterine bleeding, menorrhagia, and postmenopausal bleeding. And the non-bleeding causes include secondary and primary infertility. Serial biopsies are done in case of assessment of endometrium when the patient is on hormonal therapy. And biopsies are also taken before doing a hysterectomy, like if there are any indication for hysterectomy, like an ovarian neoplasm. So in that case, is also biopsy is indicated. Now we are coming on to the causes for abnormal uterine bleeding. So abnormal uterine bleeding is a uterine bleeding which is abnormal in duration, volume, and frequency. Now there are various causes for abnormal uterine bleeding. So there abortion, retained products of conception, anovulatory cycles seen in polycystic ovarian syndrome, and malignancies and hyperplasia. And the perimenopausal bleeding causes include anovulatory cycles, which lead to withdrawal bleeding, cycling endometrium in cases of fibroids and adenomyosis. Endometrial causes include endometritis, cervical carcinoma, endometrial carcinoma, or neoplasia, and there are certain iatrogenic causes. Now, in a postmenopausal woman, the most common cause of abnormal uterine bleeding is an atrophy. Polyps and coagulopathies can also lead to abnormal uterine bleeding. And the pregnancy-related cause include an intrauterine pregnancy or an ectopic pregnancy or a gestational trophoblastic disease. Now, there are various procedures for obtaining an endometrial tissue. The most commonly used is an office-based biopsy. Because it provides a representative sample and it is convenient for the patient, and it is cost effective. Because why it is convenient? Because there is no need of a cervical dilatation. Now it may contain sufficient tissue to ensure that may not contain sufficient tissue to ensure that endometrium has been adequately sampled, and it is accurate for the diffuse lesions, but the focal lesions such as polyp, it may be missed on it. Cervical dilatation is not necessary. Now here what we can see is a Pipel's device. This is commonly used to obtain an office-based biopsy. Now it is known to sample 4.2% of the endometrium, and it is preferred over dilatation and curettage because it preserves the stromal morphology. So it is commonly used. So this is how we obtain a biopsy with the help of a Pipel's device. So by a to and fro motion, a biopsy is obtained, and the tissue plug is obtained, which might be blood mixed, and that then it is put into a formalin solution. Now here what we can see, this picture, this is an inadequate sample obtained by a Pipel's device. Why am I calling it inadequate? Because the endometrial morphology is not clear in this microscopic view, and the gland is to stroma ratio is not very evident. So this is an inadequate sample obtained by Pipel's. On the other hand, this what we see here is it is a scanner view of the sample which is obtained by a Pipel's device, and it is revealing mostly blood. Now these are other two devices which can be used for obtaining an office-based biopsy. So this is a tau brush, and its principle is also on mechanical removal of the biopsy sample, and this is a Wabra aspirate. Now the other method is a curettage. So there are two types of curettage, a complete and an fractional curettage. So complete curettage is an ideal method, and fractional curettage has a advantage because it helps in localizing the site and extent of malignancy, and it helps us in evaluating the endocervical changes that develop during the hormone therapy. Now, curettage is considered as a gold standard method, and cervical dilatation and endometrial curettage, it provides more tissue for evaluation. But the rate of infection, perforation, and hemorrhage are more in case of curettage. Now, this is how an endometrial curettage sample is obtained. So this is a speculum. First, uterine sound is introduced to look for the uterus position and depth. Then the curette is introduced and the endometrium is scraped off. Now, what is the proper time? How do we select for a proper time for curettage? So in infertile patients, it is shortly before the onset of menstruation. In menorrhagia, where there is a prolonged bleeding due to irregular shedding, 5 to 10 days after the onset of menstruation. And in metrorrhagia, where there is an irregular cycle, so it is done without delay, when much of the endometrium is still available for examination. Now, pregnancy should always be excluded before performing a curettage because it might lead to an induced abortion. Now, preparation of endometrial specimen. So 4% of neutral solution of formaldehyde is used, and adequate fixation is important. So it ranges from minimum 6 hours to an overnight fixation is enough. Now, routine staining, hematoxylin and eosin are used. Now, what to know before interpreting a biopsy? So it is very important to know whether the patient is on any hormonal medications to control the bleeding prior to sampling, any oral contraceptive pills or any hormone replacement therapy. All this is important because hormones play a very important role, because the patient might have a disordered proliferative endometrium because of the estrogenic effect of the hormones. Also, the patient age, menopausal status and pregnancy status are equally important. Now, interpretation of endometrial specimen. So it may contain admixtures of small pieces from various endometrial layers. Now, endometrium from fundus is suitable for diagnosis, because if you take it from the isthmus, so isthmus is not hormone responsive, so the fundus is preferred. For functional disturbances, functionalis layer is of diagnostic value. Any ATPR should be reported. Early adenomatous or carcinomatous changes are best detected in the basal layers. Now, why are we preferring a functionalis layer? Because there are two reasons. It is very, very hormone responsive. It is the most hormone responsive layer. And the functionalis layer has a lining, surface lining epithelium. So that falls under the criteria of adequacy. That is why we prefer the functionalis layer. So regions of necrosis are always to be reported. Myomatous proliferations, they indicate presence of submucous leiomyomas as a cause of functional bleeding. And endometrium that we have discussed in isthmic region is unsuitable for functional diagnosis. It might give a false impression of atrophy. Now, here we see a microscopic view of the uterus, different layers of the uterus. So here, this is the surface lining epithelium, under which lies the stratum functionalis, and below that lies the stratum basalis. So these are two layers of the endometrium. Right below the basalis lies the myometrium. Now, we have discussed this stratum functionalis. It is the most hormone responsive layer. So we take the samples from this layer only. Now, coming on to the adequacy of specimen. So an adequate sample is defined which has a sufficient size to determine the gland to stroma ratio, and it demonstrates the endometrial morphological features, and it contains the surface epithelium. So this is an algorithm explaining us the adequacy of endometrial biopsy specimen. Now, we get an endometrial biopsy specimen. It might be from the Pipel's device or by a curettage. Now, we see that there is no endometrial tissue. So we say that it is an adequate sample. Now, still the ultrasound is abnormal, and there is a strong clinical suspicion, either of them. So we would suggest for a re-biopsy. Next condition is when we have superficial strips of endometrial glands. Again, we find it as an unaccessible sample. But here in this case, the ultrasound is normal, so we would not suggest for a re-biopsy. But yes, if the ultrasound would have been abnormal or there might be a clinical suspicion, so we would go for a re-biopsy. Now, if you get an intact organized tissue, that is a type specimen. So the type specimen is with an intact surface lining epithelium, and you can see a good gland to stroma ratio. So that falls into an adequate sample. Now, evaluation of tissue. So gross description. So what would a gross description for an endometrium biopsy should contain? So we explain about the appearance of tissue. How is it received? Is it received fresh or is it received in a fixative? What is the weight, size or the measurement of the tissue? Now, in case of biopsy, generally all tissue is submitted and stated. Now, as a small example, how a gross description is written. So here we are saying specimen is labeled as endometrial curettage. Now, it is important to mention the method by which the sample has been taken, because every method has its own success rates and sample adequacy. Like PIPLS and dilatation curettage, they both have a sample adequacy of around 96%. But if we talk about the aspiration cytology, it has a sample adequacy of just 63%. But talking about PIPLS itself, it has a 100% sensitivity and 98% specificity to identify the pre-malignant or malignant conditions. So it is important to know how the sample has been taken so that we can correlate with the clinician if we are not satisfied with the biopsy. So for our reporting also, we can suggest the method. So received fresh and consists of multiple fragments, the color of the tissue, and it is admixed with blood clots, the measurement of the tissue, and it is entirely submitted in one cassette. Here we're talking about the endometrial biopsy interpretation. So we basically look for the glands in the stoma. So what would we look for in the glands? We'll ask whether the glands are, like we'll see whether the glands are evenly spaced out. What is the glandis to stoma ratio? Are the glands round or dilated? Is there any branching, any secretory activity? So we look for the vacuolation or any luminal secretions are there. What about the lining epithelium? Is it pseudostratified or is it low cuboidal or columnar? Or mitosis is present or not. What would we look for in the stroma? So whether it is compact or is it cellular? Is it loose edematous? How are the stromal cells? Whether they are spindly, ovoid imparting a blue color, or plump with moderate cytoplasm imparting eosinophilic appearance. So cytoplasm imparting eosinophilic appearance is pseudo-decidual change, which is seen because of the effect of progesterone. So this we would find in a secretory endometrium. Presence of spiral arterioles and ectatic vessels, hemorrhage, granulocytes, and collapsed stromal walls. Now, we'll talk about some of the artifacts. Now, severe freezing artifacts occur when endometrial tissue in formalin solution is allowed to freeze slowly. By handling the curette, endometrial glands are squeezed and lining epithelium lies within the glandular lumen. So that gives a gland within gland appearance. Now, differential diagnosis for adipose tissue in endometrial samples, it could be a uterine perforation or it could be a lipoleomyoma. So this should be stated to the clinician as soon as possible.
We have to know that severe freezing artifacts occurs when endometrial tissue in formalin solution is allowed to freeze slowly. What is the meaning of this?
Ma'am, when we are fixing the endometrial tissue, so like if we... Like if we have a minimum...
Are we fixing something?
No ma'am, we are fixing it. So...
Just elaborate on the first line. Allowed to freeze slowly.
No ma'am, we are not freezing, we are just fixing, but if it gets...
Why did you write that? Allowed to freeze slowly.
Sorry.
Because everybody is listening what you are saying, what you have... posted over there, what you have written in your publication or whatever it is, freezing.
So here what we see is a freezing artifact, and here this is a gland within gland artifact which simulates the glandular crowding. Now this is artifactual crowding of glands due to artifactual stromal fragmentation, and this here what we see is a retraction of stroma around the glands, so this is giving a halo effect. Here this is telescoping of the gland, and this is pseudolipomatosis where we can see clear vacuoles devoid of nuclei. Now this what we see is adipose tissue amongst the endometrium. Now this indicates a uterine perforation. Another differential is a lipoleomyoma. Now talking about the normal endometrium, so early proliferative or a menstrual endometrium we'll be discussing first. So what happens is estrogen and progesterone levels are low. Now this is going to inhibit the negative feedback to the pituitary and the hypothalamus, now which is going to increase the FSH and follicular maturation. So this will lead to sloughing of the secretory endometrium. Now what are the reasons for assigning date to an endometrial biopsy? This is to interpret the cycle based on histomorphology of the endometrium, the need to establish that ovulation has taken place or not, to determine if assigned date falls within the expected range based on patient's last menstrual period, and to determine dissynchronous maturation of the endometrial glands in relation to the stroma. Now, coming on to dating of endometrium. So, we talk about the menstrual endometrium first. Now, inflammatory cells are seen in the endometrium. There are thrombi in stromal vessels, and there is dissociation of the glands from stroma, which gives rise to these stromal blue balls. This is because of the condensation and collapse of the stroma, we see such stromal blue balls. Now, again, there's a picture. So this is complete fragmentation of the gland and stroma. And this is thrombosis of stromal vessels. Here, what we see, this pink, this is because of the fibrin material. Talking about the early proliferative endometrium, which is in the first 5 days. So the glands are going to be straight and tubular. Glands in cross section will appear like little blue donuts. The epithelium is very important. We should remember it is a pseudo stratified columnar epithelium here. All epithelial cells are in contact with the basement membrane of gland, and the mitotic activities are seen in gland and stroma. If only one is present, it will confirm the proliferative phase of endometrium. Now, what we see over here, the orange arrow is showing us the mitosis over here, and this blue arrow shows us the pseudo stratification. And these are the little blue donuts seen on a cross section of an early proliferative endometrium. Talking about the mid to late proliferative endometrium, so there's going to be an increased coiling of glands. Mitotic activity will also increase in both the glands and stroma. Stromal edema in mid-proliferative phase will be seen. This is important. Nuclei have coarse chromatin. It should not be interpreted neoplastic because the glands and the nuclei are organized. Spindle stroma, it might be misinterpreted as pre-decidua, and increased tortuosity of glands in the late proliferative phase. So here what we see is the glands are beginning to coil. So, and there is certain amount of stromal edema. And you can see here is stromal mitotic figures are seen. Talking about the late proliferative endometrium, there's extensive coiling of glands, but still there are some glands which are tubular. And this is a cross section, which is showing us that there's certain amount of glandular crowding. Talking about interval endometrium, which is day 15, 16 and post-ovulatory day 2 to 3. So it will have features of both proliferative and secretory endometrium. Subnuclear vacuoles will be present. Mitosis will persist, but it will disappear when it goes into the secretory phase, and glands have proliferative architecture. Now, secretory endometrium is day 17 to 28. So day 17 is most recognizable. It has a piano key appearance because of the subnuclear vacuoles. Mitosis is going to be rare. Secretory vacuoles are present. Now, epithelium here is no longer pseudostratified. Now it has become a single layer epithelium. Vacuoles, they move towards the gland lumen, and there are secretions in the gland. Now, day 18, the vacuoles are both above and below the gland nuclei, and day 19, they are above the gland nuclei. Day 20, the secretion is at peak. Now, after this, secretory phase will take place in the stroma as glands are now exhausted. So, they have a sawtooth appearance. So, day 21, there will be beginning of stromal edema. Day 22, it will be a peak stromal edema. Day 23, you will see sawtooth infoldings because of the secretory exhaustion, and there will be spiral arterioles in stroma. Day 24, there will be more exhaustion, spiral arterioles in pre-decidual cuffing. Day 25 will have pre-decidua under surface epithelium. Day 26, it will expand, the pre-decidua will expand, and by day 27, entire stroma is pre-decidualized and there will be influx of the inflammatory cells. Now, this is a piano key appearance which is seen on day 17. So, there will be subnuclear vacuoles and single layer of glandular epithelium, and there will be no mitosis. So, these are the subnuclear vacuoles. 18, as I told you, that vacuoles will be both above and below the nuclei. So above and below, and day 19, they are entirely above the nuclei. So they are migrated to the luminal surface. Now this is day 23, in which the orange arrow is showing us the spiral arterioles. Now this is surrounded by a pre-decidua. The blue arrow shows us that there is luminal secretion and glands have a low cuboidal lining. Day 25, 26, the glands have started showing us corkscrewing, and the stroma, it is pre-decidualized. Now, why dating of endometrium, it is outdated now, because we have better techniques of dating the endometrium like ultrasonography or hormonal assessment. So we do not date endometrium on the basis of biopsy, and we are just here to classify it whether it is proliferative or is it secretory. Talking about atrophic endometrium, so there's a lack of hormonal stimulation which leads to endometrial atrophy. There'll be non-secretory glands. There'll be a flattened epithelium which will be devoid of mitotic activity, and the glands become cystic. There'll be a flattened non-proliferating epithelium. So this is to differentiate between the atrophy and simple hyperplasia. So here what we see is glands are tubular C to cystic. The arrow is showing us stroma is inactive with minimal mitotic activity. What is the pathology for anovulatory cycle? So it is because the estrogen is showing its effect. The progesterone, anovulation means that ovulation is not taking place. So the corpus luteum is not forming. So the progesterone is not secreted. So the effects of progesterone are not seen. The estrogen is showing its effect. So it is focal gland dilatation and crowding, disordered proliferation, and thin wall ectatic cysts. Now, talking about disordered proliferative endometrium, so it can be because of an anovulatory cycle, a patient is developing a disordered proliferative endometrium, and it might lead to hyperplasia. Report will mention this as a secretory endometrium. Now, why is it important to mention no granuloma seen? Because in our country, genital tuberculosis is one of the leading causes of infertility. So we have to mention whether we could see a granuloma or not. The stroma is appearing loose, larger cells, more abundant cytoplasm, so we can see a decidual change. That is what we mentioned, that genital tuberculosis is important cause, so our report should mention about it. Now, coming on to chronic endometritis. Now, this is one of the causes of infertility and recurrent pregnancy loss as well. Now, plasma cells with or without lymphoid follicles. So, plasma cells are seen and spindle stromal cells are seen. So, here this picture, spindle cell alteration of the stroma. This is especially around the glands which we can see, the spindle cell. So, structural abnormalities like polyps, submucosal leiomyoma can be associated with plasma cells. So, it should not be misdiagnosed with chronic endometritis. Now we are talking about endometrial hyperplasia. So what is the definition? Proliferation of glands or of irregular size and shape with increased gland to stroma ratio as compared to the proliferative endometrium. Generally, it's a diffuse process. It may also be focal. Now, classification is based on architectural pattern and cytological atypia. Now we'll talk about the architectural pattern. So it is based on degree of glandular crowding. So it can be divided into simple and complex. Now WHO classifies it as simple hyperplasia, complex hyperplasia, simple atypical hyperplasia, and complex atypical hyperplasia. Now there are simple hyperplasia has a risk factor of transforming into carcinoma is less than 2%, simple atypical is around 8%, and complex atypical is around 29%. Hence, cytological atypia increases the risk of progression to carcinoma more than the architectural changes. So that's a more important factor. Now this is explaining us that simple hyperplasia without atypia and complex hyperplasia without atypia. Now these are both hyperplasias without atypia. So they have an extremely low risk of progression to carcinoma. So they can be managed conservatively by normalization of the cycles, by weight loss of the patient, by oral contraceptives. On the other hand, if we have a simple hyperplasia with atypia and a complex hyperplasia with atypia, so now there's an extremely high risk of progression to carcinoma. And hysterectomy, total hysterectomy with bilateral sulfingo-oophorectomy is done, and in some exceptional cases, they might be managed conservatively. So clinical features and etiology. So abnormal uterine bleeding is the most common clinical feature. Etiology, it is persistent anovulation, exogenous unopposed estrogenic stimulation, and polycystic ovarian disease. Now here, we talk about the perimenopausal abnormal uterine bleeding or menorrhagia as one of the other presenting features. So here we are looking at the transvaginal ultrasound or TVS is the modality of choice for evaluation of endometrial thickness. So normally 5 mm is the cutoff. If it is more than 5 mm, hyperplasia is suspected and endometrium is sampled. Now, this is simple hyperplasia without ATPR. So here what you can see is the glands are irregular. They are cystically dilated and they are separated by abundant stroma. And there's an increase in the gland to stroma ratio and there is focal crowding. Here what you can see is glandular cell nuclei are oval and they are pseudostratified and there are uniform outlines. This is complex hyperplasia without ATPR. So why am I calling it complex? Because glands here are closely packed. Here the glands were kind of spaced out because of the stroma, but here the glands are closely packed. And there is lack of abundant stroma. And there is crowding and branching of the glands as well. Now here what we can see is oval basally oriented nuclei. The word oval is important because shape of the nuclei is important. So oval basally oriented nuclei and abundant mitotic figures are seen. Now talking about atypical, where there is ATPR. So the cells will be stratified. There will be loss of polarity. There will be increased NS2C ratio. There will be enlarged, now the nuclei here are round nuclei. They have coarse chromatin, irregular nuclear membrane and a prominent nucleoli. Now evaluation of ATPR is most important feature in evaluation of the endometrial hyperplasia. Now this is atypical hyperplasia, so the glands are irregular, there's small amount of stroma. Round vesicular nuclei here, see there are round nuclei and they have a prominent nucleoli and rounding of nuclei suggests ATP.
What is loss of polarity over here?
Ma'am,
what is this loss of polarity over there?
Ma'am, they are not organized with the basement membrane.
What is the loss of polarity? You also use this word number of times in cervical malignancies, in cervical lining epithelium, any lining epithelium. You always write loss of polarity, loss of polarity.
Ma'am, they're disorganized in
disorderly arranged sets.
Yes.
That's loss of polarity. Yes. Did they discuss? Karma, did they talk on the mitotic activity? Look at the lining epithelium, it's disorderly arranged. You get the basement membrane the cells, they're refilled. Or you get the lining epithelium, not even microcervix also, basal, intermediate, and superficial. How they are seen like this, then a little bit of object, and then parallel. So that is the absolutely normal polarity. Loss of polarity means everything is disturbed.
We'll talk about some benign mimics of the endometrial hyperplasia. So artifacts, cystic atrophy, lower uterine segment endometrium, disordered proliferative phase or endometrial polyps. Now, we'll talk about endometrial polyps. So most common clinical feature, they present as abnormal uterine bleeding. Less than 5% are associated with neoplasia. Now, this is a polypoid shape which we are seeing under a low power. Now this is a surface epithelium. It may be atrophic, but it is often proliferative. The glands here, see, they are cystically dilated and some are tubular also here we can see. The stroma is fibrous and it is rich in collagen and edema. There's a certain amount of edema. Vessels are important to be noted in polyps. They are thick walled blood vessels. Now, atypical hyperplasia versus well-differentiated adenocarcinoma. Now, what is the criteria for a carcinoma, adenocarcinoma? So there will be a desmoplastic stroma. There will be confluent glandular pattern, creating a cribriform pattern and extensive papillary pattern. So some information about the desmoplastic stroma.
In all malignancies, you get extensive papillary pattern?
No, ma'am.
Papillary serous carcinoma is different.
Yes, ma'am.
Again, adenocarcinoma of the endometrium is different. It's not going to show you papillary pattern. Papillary serous carcinoma, elderly females, bad prognosis.
Yes. So a desmoplastic stroma is basically because of the tumor or the neoplasm, the stroma is showing changes. So there'll be a low cellularity. It'll be sclerotic and hyalinized, and the blood vessel infiltration will be disorganized. So these are the pictures. So this
what else you get along with the desmoplastic stroma in endometrial adenocarcinoma? Desmoplastic stroma, it gives you the clue. Yes, you are dealing with the malignancy. Along with that, you get lots of foamy macrophages. Yes. Yes, ma'am, nahi, aap padha nahi hai. Sab include nahi kiya hai. Okay.
This is a cribriform pattern, this is papillary pattern, and this is a desmoplastic stroma.
My cribriform is not looking like cribriform. What do you mean like cribriform?
Ma'am,
does it look like cribriform? No. Papillary, only one gland was showing the papillary. Structure is seen only one gland.
Endometrial carcinoma, so it is most common gynecological malignancy in developed countries. According to Bookman, it is divided into type 1 and type 2. Now, type 1 is due to excessive estrogen stimulation against a background of hyperplasia. Low-grade endometrioid carcinoma, by endometrioid, I mean that on light microscopy or electron microscopy, the endometrium looks like a normal proliferative. It is similar to a normal proliferative endometrium. Type 2 is independent of estrogen stimulation and serous carcinoma and Burka germline mutation. So endometrioid and non-endometrioid, there are two entities. So endometrioid includes secretory, mucinous and squamous carcinomas. Non-endometrioid includes serous, clear cell and carcinosarcomas. So this is a hysteroscopic view of endometrial carcinoma. This is, now we'll talk about some histological types. So endometrioid adenocarcinoma, most common type, this is 90%. So grade 1. Now the glands are back to back, nuclear rounding with loss of polarity, and 5% or less solid growth pattern. So here glands are somewhat visible. Now as we move on to grade 2, the glands have started disappearing and it is more of like becoming like sheets. So 60 to 50% of solid growth pattern. This is grade 3, more than 50% solid growth pattern. And this is a villoglandular pattern seen in endometrioid type. Now adenocarcinoma with squamous differentiation. So adenocanthoma is what we call the adenocarcinoma grade 1, and benign squamous component is present. So this canthoma, it has a benign squamous component, so it has a good prognosis. Adenosquamous carcinoma is composed of grade 2 and 3 and malignant squamous component. And primary squamous cell carcinoma is rare. So we talk about the serous carcinoma. So it is seen in elderly. You can see a cytological atypia. Saumya bodies are seen. It is aggressive. It has lymphovascular invasion. And there is deep myometrial invasion. So the extent of myometrial invasion, it tells us how aggressive the carcinoma is.
Papillary. Serious. Papillary. Papillary. Sarcoma. Saumya bodies. Papillary. Always remember. Both they go hand in hand.
Clear cell carcinoma, it is also seen in elderly. It has distinct cellular margins and a large amount of glycogen is there. Hobnail configuration is seen and it has a very poor prognosis. Now, mucinous carcinoma, it has minimal atypia. Mucinous falls under the endometrioid category. So, neutrophilic infiltrates in the epithelium. One half is composed of cells with intracytoplasmic mucin and it has a good prognosis. Squamous carcinoma is rare. Squamous element is derived from metaplasia of tumor glands and it also has a poor prognosis. Now, what is the take-home message? That we have to interact with the clinician as history is a very important factor. Separate blood clots from the endometrial tissue for processing. Endometrium with surface epithelium is best for the interpretation. And do not report hyperplasia on secretory endometrium. All endometrial cancers should be typed and if appropriate, it should be graded.